Can you all hear me? I'm Kurt Ransohoff. I'm the CEO at Sansum Clinic. I'm an internist, so I am very glad to be allowed by the surgeons to introduce tonight's Sansum Clinic Visiting Professor of Surgery lecture. Before we start, though, I'll just mention that we're having some audiovisual difficulties here, and you'll be happy to know that the person that the entire hospital called to help was the chief resident of general surgery, the guy in the white coat, which proves, actually, that the chief resident of general surgery can, in fact, do anything. I said that this was the Sansum Clinic Visiting Professor of Surgery lecture, but to a very large extent, this is really a tribute to Ron Latimer. And I'd just like to mention that it was really Ron's inspiration, his passion, his guidance that has nourished this program from its inception. And I'd really like to just take a moment and just honor Ron for his efforts. This program really exists to advance surgical educational opportunities for the community practicing physicians, as well as the surgical residents in training here at Cottage, and to demonstrate our commitment to the quality surgical care of patients. This lecture, and there's another lecture tomorrow, as well as this whole academic week, because Dr. Polk has been here since Monday, has been made possible by the generous support of many donors, many of you in this room, I suspect, patients and non-patients, Sansum Clinic trustees and staff, many community physicians, physician groups, and corporate contributors. I really want to also recognize Ron Werft and Cottage Hospital for once again being the title sponsor. They sponsored the first lecture series last year as well. The way this works is there's a selection committee for the visiting professor program that consists of the clinic's active surgical staff. That's Dr. Jim Dunn, Gregory Graney, Rosa Choi, Paul Chizik, Mark Zaray, plus Dr. Jeffrey Govin, who's right there, and Steve Kaminsky, who are involved in the Cottage full-time teaching program. It's a distinct honor to have with us a physician of the highest caliber, really a world-class surgeon, Dr. Hiram Polk, Jr., who is the Ben A. Reed Senior Professor of Surgery Emeritus at the University of Louisville School of Medicine. Dr. Polk is joined by his wife, Dr. Susan Galandwick, that's not an easy name to pronounce. Dr. Galandwick is an extremely accomplished person in her own right. She is the director of the section of colon and rectal surgery and the Price Institute of Surgical Research at the Department of Surgery at the University of Louisville School of Medicine. Immediately following tonight's lecture, there will be a reception across the street in the Sansum Clinic Julie and Jack Nadel lobby. We invite you all to come and enjoy the time over there. So at this point, I will turn it over to Dr. Latimer, who will get to introduce Dr. Polk.
Thank you very much, Kurt. As always, there's always a little glitch. And we've been working on the media for the week, and we did pretty well. Surgery Grand Rounds, all the slides were in yellow and red. Today we're hoping everything goes well. I do want to thank all of you for coming. I certainly want to thank all of the donors and people who have provided the financial support for this program. This is a week of taking an expert, bringing him to our town, and picking his brain. Dr. Polk has did a journal club on Monday. He and his wife actually did the journal club on Monday. He's done lectures almost every day. He's doing some board examinations of the surgical residents so we can get them ready to go out into the real world. I've known Dr. Polk for a long time, mainly through his writings, but at various meetings he's always been a star in lecturing. I've learned a lot from him. The residents have learned a lot from him. He's written probably about 450 different papers, about 10 books, 38 manuscripts. But in the surgical world, there's probably, in my mind, two pinnacles. Not quite the Nobel Prize, but darn close. One is to be elected president of the American Surgical Association. That is a very select group of surgeons in the United States. It's a real honor to be the president of that, and Dr. Polk has been that. He's been a forerunner in surgical research. And the second accolade is to have a what's called the surgical forum. It's all research papers that are done by research physicians and surgeons that's awarded every year, and he received that as they dedicated one of the year's books to him. I could go on. His CV is a quarter of a ream of paper on every other page, and I'm not going to go through that, and you'll be happy to hear that. He does have an avocation, and you're going to hear about that today. And I would also, as Kurt mentioned to you, his talk tomorrow is going to be, I think, also for people who are interested in medicine. He's going to talk about a possible shortage of surgeons, and perhaps how the Accountable Care Act is going to affect all of the people in this room, including me and everyone else. So it is a distinct honor and a pleasure to introduce Dr. Hiram Polk.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Let me say a few things in introduction. First of all, this is an old-fashioned professor pro tem kind of visiting professorship. The standard and the norm in America today is fly in as late as you can on Thursday night and leave as quick as you can on Saturday morning. You will have met whoever drove you to the airport and maybe one other person. You will remember none of them. The nice thing about this week, it's been an in-depth opportunity to be with the residents and the staff here at the Cottage Hospital, and it's just been a great pleasure to do something in that format. Let me say, and I...
Could you turn the mic up a little?
No. No, it's not as managed to be.
Can I just ask everyone to be sure to turn on your cell phones?
All right. I'll turn mine off, too.
Let's try that. I bet it's okay. In all movie theaters...
Yeah, okay. Now, back to where we were. We can't have any more of these. Let me tell you a little about the subject for tonight, and we'll take a little longer because we started later, and I really want to share this with you. I think if you work in a field of medicine in any time, it's always been challenging. I think if you work in what I've spent my lifetime in academic medicine, you're not only worried about here today, tomorrow, but you're worried about educating the next generation of surgeons that you hope will be better than you were and hope that they will set higher standards than you have. If you feel that way and that's your day job, having something you really like to do outside that is really important. I worked at the racetrack in Boston when I was in medical school. I wrote for the racing form. I've owned horses off and on since my adult lifehood. Some of the nicest things in my life are involved in what I'm going to talk to you about tonight, but I think the romance piece of this is actually pretty easy. The reality piece gets ugly towards the end, and because we had such a grand visit yesterday to Doug Herthel and the group up in Santa Ynez, I think you've got people here who are absolutely hands-on and fingers on the pulse of this. So I want to share it all with you in a lengthy review of some things I think will be fun, and I hope for all of us. Horse racing began 1,000 years ago in the sands of the Persian Gulf when Bedouin Arabs began to race their horses against each other. They turned out to be a curious breed of horse. They were very refined in appearance, had uncommon stamina, could run for long distances, but not terribly fast. And that's the way that evolved for nearly 500 years, and the British explorers of the 17th century began to bring occasionally one of these horses back. And that's where the modern story begins. You can imagine, let's see, we don't, some of these pictures are decent. We might turn that off if we could, Ron, you didn't see me. Maybe that's better. Any case, this became a kind of sport, and it was brought into favor by the Stuart kings. And of course, the right part of that was Newmarket, which is very near Cambridge in England, that most of you know is still the headquarters for racing in the world. And this is an early scene there. And the reigning king ensconced his mistress there, Nell Gwynn, and the principal race for two-year-old fillies at Newmarket 300 years later is called the Nell Gwynn Stakes. The appearance, as you can see here, is one of progressive orderliness, proper stands, some organization of racing in a way, and the British Jockey Club did a job of putting this somewhere into reality in the 18th century. This is a perfect picture from a day at the races at Epsom, which is in Surrey, just south of London. And there are all kinds of individuals you wouldn't want to be seen with sorting around here taking advantage of one another. I've got the fastest horse, you want to bet on it. The Windsor family got into this very early with King Edward VII when he was still regent. And he not only won the Derby, but he won the British Triple Crown twice in a five-year period. This is one of those horses. The family today is still in racing. The Queen Mother was a great person till her 100th birthday, went to the races. The big racing in England is actually taking place this week at Cheltenham for steeplechase over jumps, but that's another game. The royal family is still in it, and Queen Elizabeth has been an active participant and a visitor to Kentucky many times. The artwork got into this too at the same time, and this became a scene for many of the best of the Impressionist pictures, and this is just one of dozens of those that are spectacularly good. When people immigrated to America, the British still brought their love of the horse there, and you'll see several things here. One, they were starved African-American riders, and then instead of playing the NBA, they were midgets. That's what childhood starvation does for you. And you also notice that this is over a skinned racetrack of dirt, because we race in America every day in the same place. In Britain and in Europe, they tend to race a place for two or three days, move on to the next town, and come back in a couple of weeks. So this is part of what goes with it. This is sort of one of the main tombstones that you would see in Kentucky, the fleetest and gamest and most generous of horses. So there's a lot of that appreciated. However, the growth of racing has vacillated back and forth. As you know, the Prince of Condé thought he would come back to life as a horse, and he wanted to have an adequate stable. And this is his stables that he prepared and built in Chantilly. This is the running of the French Derby, which still takes place in early June every year, the Prix du Jockey Club around that corner and on that same racetrack. The story about racing is a rich one, and there are all kind of stories that go from this, and there's a proper thing. This is Cheltenham, which is in the Midlands, and it's where they're running this week with the Steeplechase Championships of the World there. I think there is something for my lifetime about the outside of a horse. It's been good for the inside of me. It's a great place to escape, and it's a great place to recommit yourself to something that's good. Inevitably, in something like this, money gets in it to a real degree. The short little man with the walking stick was a genius who studied horses. He bred horses. He trained his own horses, and for a long time, he rode them. The good news is somewhere he met this taller lady who was wealthy and was able to let him play the game he wanted to. In doing so, Miss Tissio bred some of the best horses in the world, the bottom one being Nyarko, who influenced everything today 75 years later. So it's French, British, American, Italian, everybody else has been in this. In the 1960s, you had what was the emergence of the international outcross, and the story behind this is breeding of one sort or another. The most isolated, durable of American bloods with the best of the classic horses from Europe and in every way. Nyarko, Rebo, and Seabird were the world's greatest racehorses, but even though they were successful as stallions, it turned out that Kentucky breds began to dominate the world. Sir Ivor Nijinsky and Vincent O'Brien in Tipperary dominated European racing for the 70s and 80s. All of those, so everyone came here in one sense or another. Kentucky was, for a long time, the only place that you could buy toughness and speed. Like tulips, however, there's an altered flow of the market, which comes back and forth. And we've seen the Japanese, when their market was good, come in and buy up our very best horses. Sunday Silence was a huge loss from California to the Japanese, maybe the best stallion of the last 50 years there, not here. And then you've got the Irish Stallion Masters, and I'll tell you a little more about how they made that work and take things into that. The Middle Eastern oil wealth, that's not old wealth, it should be all wealth, is substantial, and they've been the current contributors to some of the explosion of growth in the field. This might come down to a single horse that the old Aga bred near the beginning of World War II. Nasrullah was a wonderfully temperamental horse who had more skills and intrinsic ability than most anybody. He was imported to Kentucky in 1956. And was champion sire in America 7 times. His son, Bull Ruler, was champion sire in America 12 times. So this is the sort of thing that grew out of this. This was purely Irish and French bred horse, comes to America, and with the outcross that happened with our bloodstock, something dynamite occurred. A piece of that dynamite was Secretariat, that most of you know. He's a grandson of Nyarko, a remarkable horse. and really a pretty good racehorse and just a below average sire. I want to tell you what a sire he was. This filly, of course, is a sister to our very best horse by Secretariat. And as my grandson said when we went to a race, he says, "Granddad, your horse ain't very fast." And she was just terrible. She couldn't run a yard. But she looked like Secretariat, and that's the harmony of this whole business. Now, I want to try to see if I can show you a short video of a horse sale, and just let me talk over it for a minute. Horse sales are things where you read about the horse that brings $1 million, but in fact, the median for the sale is zero, because people buy their horses back, they get hurt at the last minute, they don't get there. You want to watch the money run here in a kind of painless way. Can I turn this up anyway, the audio?
It's up.
Can you make it any louder? The fun part of this is how quickly and painlessly this thing zips. There are only two people bidding. You can't tell who they are, but they were determined. That's all you need is two. Notice the guy picking up manure. That's from the horse, not me. Now, the interesting piece about that horse named Canadian Peso, he won two nice races at a major racetrack, got hurt, and is a dressage horse in New York State now. He earned about 5 cents on the dollar for his purchase price. So we'll come back to the economics of that in a minute, but let me go on back with the story. The Arabs and the Irish did a really good thing. They'd sent the horse here, they bought back all the good horses. And they have dominated thoroughbred racing and breeding in the world for the last 30 years. And they did it with simple good judgment, unbelievable amounts of money committed to it over and over again. And the new Aga Khan, the current Aga Khan IV, has been a big factor in this, picking up his grandfather's legend to continue to breed horses in a good way. So you see the Dubai family, the Irishman John Magner, Khalid Abdullah, Saudi Arabia, and the Yoshidas from Japan. They all own and breed their own horses in Kentucky right across the road from one another. So we, in essence, have them back, but on the other hand, they own them. Point number three is a really important piece for the people in the audience. The capacity to predict ovulation of a mare by ultrasound, transrectal ultrasound, is phenomenal. You therefore can breed a mare at a time when she's more likely to ovulate. You therefore can breed stallions to more mares with a higher conception rate just because of the timing of the ovulation. There's several things about this. So we went from 40 mares a year to 100 and now to more than 200. And then if you buy a well-insured 747, you can put 20 stallions on them in different ends of them, fly them to Australia, and let them work the southern hemisphere where the breeding season is just the opposite. You know, some of the younger guys think this is funny. These little horses don't like this a bit. They know they get on that airplane, it's no vacation. Same thing again. The Japanese were also very clever, and they said, you know, if you can breed horses this many things, if you can breed the standard thing in Kentucky, you get a 40-share syndicate for, let's say, $50,000 for each one of them, that's $2 million. On the other hand, if you could have 70 shares in the syndicate, which gives you a right to breed one mare a year, then you're gonna be able to almost double that. So that's the way they took Sunday Silence away, and we were unable to compete and not nearly as wise as others. Now, the gambling business, as most of you know, horse racing in America is controlled by gambling and promoted by gambling, and the purse is some tiny little amount of what's bet on the thing. just as our politicians have told us there'll be no new taxes, the proliferation of other kind of gambling has just been amazing. There are lotteries all over everywhere, and they're offshore in all kind of protected casinos, which you have them here. And so racing has lost more and more of its appeal as one of the few kinds of legal gambling in the world. So this is a lament that we didn't keep up at a time we should have. We avoided television when NFL and NBA thought it was a pretty good idea. Now, this, what's involved in this? Bloodlines mean a lot. You want a horse with a leg at each corner. Fertility of a mare is really important. A good mare and a well-managed farm will have two foals in 3 years. So you're going to miss about every third year doing this, but fertility is important, confirmation is important. Ultimately, the racetrack is where these horses perform. They can look pretty all you like, as you saw with the one that was sold in the sale drain, gorgeous looking horse, but was not able structurally sound enough to continue to race. The second, third thing, or sixth thing, is availability of the horse. There are remarkable fashions and bloodlines that come and go, and most of all, most of the people who have been successful have persisted over a long, long time. So these are the elements of what it takes to play this game and why it's so attractive. Now I'm gonna try one more, and this is a longer little stretch of things, and this is the filly down the inside in the white, won more stakes races at Churchill Downs than any horse, and it's 237 years. Her name is Mrs. Revere, and she was an important part of my life. This is where she's running against a mare named from California, the gray filly named Lady Secret, who was Horse of the Year this very year. And she's going to try to catch her from the outside. She's way out here yet. Okay. So you lose by that way. The black mare with the white silks here. You'll see this again. And that's a principal grade one race for female horses in America.
Is Northern Emerald, owned by Hiram C. Polk Jr. and J. David Richardson, trained by Bill Mott, written today by Home Perez. Time.
She is 25 years old now. I think you recognize the speaker. John Forsyth did the Eclipse Award at Coronado for us for many, many years. And a young man had ridden a lot for us happened to win this. I presume this is going to go forward soon. Can I hit this again? Well, maybe I will, maybe I won't. I hate that we missed that. That would have been fun to see. But let's go back to the story. The commercial facts of life, I said the median price for horses that sell is nearly zero. They're either scratched because of unsoundness or because the owner doesn't agree with the price and buys them back. The average is one number, the median is another. $1 million headline near zero median, so it's very hard to make money even selling horses. It costs $100 a day to train a horse at the racetrack today, plus the fact that the rider and trainer get about 10% each, and the veterinarians probably take off another 20%. So it's a little bit of a tough game that doesn't make a lot of economic sense now. What happened in 2008 was a sequence of high-profile deaths and breakdowns of horses that changed what we tried to do in this game. Pine Island died at the Churchill Downs at the Breeders' Cup. Barbaro, as most of you know, broke his leg in the Preakness when he was defeated and then lived for quite some time before he died. George Washington broke off his leg in the Breeders' Cup at Monmouth Park in the fall of 07. And the coup d'etat was eight bells. The filly who'd run second in the Derby, as she galloped out after the race was over, broke both her front legs. As the phone rang all night that night and started early the next morning, we began to try to make some changes in what's a complicated process. Now, this is not going to be a detailed lecture, but these are the things that we know that contribute to safety and soundness in the horse. There's an evolving phenotype in which we've bred a lot of fast horses that are not necessarily structurally sound in Kentucky. They're racing surfaces. Some of them are very dangerous. Some of them are slightly safer. The artificial racetracks are about 1% less likely to have a breakdown than the dirt tracks. And the grass are a little less than both of those. whether you start a horse at age 2 or 2.5 or age 3 seems to matter to some. We basically don't run two-year-olds because we breed horses to run a little late. There's been a worldwide shift where there's a more issue with fast horses, and therefore the Kentucky horses stay alive and well and attractive. Whips and horse racing are ugly things to a lot of people that watch that on the television. Flogging a tired horse is one thing. Whipping a horse to get them to realize they've got some competition, need to wake up, is another thing. We now have safer, less painful whips that are broad, flat, make a lot of noise, but don't hurt a lot. Shoes, for example, 8 Bells had on the most dangerous kind of shoes you could possibly wear in racing. They had a toe grab on the front and a rim inside that, which gives you great traction when you're fresh and eager and out of the gate. When you're finishing a long, hard race, it tends to make you stumble. She stumbled and broke both legs. Butazolidine and Lasix are two drugs. Butazolidine is a wonderful non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agent for horses. Much better in horses than people. Tears up their stomach like everybody else's does. Lasix is a drug which we've been unable to reach closure on, and I'll come back to about that. Horses breathe inefficiently. They have a very poor respiratory tract. They breathe inefficiently. When they do, they get tiny little rupture of membranes in the pulmonary alveoli, which will tend to produce a little microscopic bleeding into the trachea. There's one horse in 1,000 that'll drop his head at the end of a race and blood will pour out, and it'll turn out to be maybe 100 cc's of blood, but it's like a drop in the toilet bowl. It looks like a million. So it's an ugly thing. You can prevent that with Lasix. You can lessen it with Lasix, but then there's some other problems associated with that. California perfected the idea of bicarbonate loading, which is just exactly what you would do with any kind of athlete you wanted to go out. Many people who run, load yourselves with bicarbonate. It will reduce acidosis, lower your pH, and is fairly effective, so-called milkshakes. We've now made anabolic steroids, or the famous story about Big Brown when he won the Derby. The fool who trained him said we've had him on steroids for months. And then that was fine. He won the Derby, won the Preakness, ran last in the Belmont. Guess what? They took him off his steroids. What happens to somebody who withdraws steroids after 6 weeks? They're like the bottom falls out of them. So they're dangerous both ways. Totally illegal and designer drugs are things called frog juice from Brazil, elephant juice from France, you name it, we've tried it. They found things that will either stimulate or dull a horse, and they've been used by people again and again. We need a full-time research component, which Davis, by the way, if I forget to mention it, Davis, the UC Vet School at Davis is just the best in the world. And of the new vet schools, it's way, way up here, and they do all of these things uncommonly well. We've got a problem. You're going to go to the guys at Davis because they'll be more likely able to help you the quickest. The laboratories to check for drugs in horses in America have typically been done on a low bid basis. You know, not cefabid, but low bid, the cheapest thing you could find. Low standards, equipment, personnel, essentially no research components at all. We certainly have the exception of that at Davis, where there's a real research staff, and the Ken Matty laboratory there is one of the best in the world. We now have really good injury reporting in competition, out of competition, and autopsies, for example, are done on every horse that dies in a training track or racetrack in California. So you got some problems here, but you're also setting some wonderful standards. The rider's health is an important thing. Riders have to keep themselves thin, or they lose their mounts, they lose their business. So we're concerned about their well-being. The penalties for doing things are very uneven. You know, you can get $1,000 fine for doping a horse to win a $1 million race, or you can get 2 weeks vacation. So our penalties are very uneven. Frozen samples, we're going to try to do what the Olympics are doing. We've had a lot of help from the WADA group, who helped us a lot with that. We're trying to do that for horse racing all over the country. Now, what I didn't tell you is drugs are essentially not used to race on in any other country in the world except America. Now, I tell you, the truth is they train on them. And the butazolidine and the horse meat that got turned up in France and England was on horses trained there, but they train on it, but they don't run on it. And I know that's a nuance most of you won't understand, but the point is we're being held to a very difficult standard. Shockwave ultrasound is a new designer thing in which you take a shockwave ultrasound thing and put it on a digital nerve, and a horse won't feel pain in his ankle or his foot. Guess how dangerous that is. And you can't exactly do a test for ultrasound, a shockwave ultrasound, at least not now. We have a tremendous problem with the unwanted horse. Most unwanted horses in America are quarter horses or backyard horses, most of which are raised in California. When the daughter goes away to school, when the horse can't run anymore, can't win anymore, or whatnot, you need a home for them. It's a lot easier to find a home for a cat or dog than it is for a horse. They cost a lot to keep up. So we have a terrible problem with the unwanted horse that nobody in America is close to solving. We have adoption agencies and all kind of people on that, and I've got the best thing in the world, a sweet girl who runs a pony club outside Louisville. When the mares get to a certain age, in Northern Emerald, 25, she probably won't have more than another foal. She'll go there to live for the rest of her life for $200 a month. But not many people can do that. Not many people will do that. So the unwanted horse is a huge problem. Now, the things that are known, let's talk about the evolving phenotype. The American horse is short on durability, unbelievable speed. What happens here is popular bloodlines sell well, mature early, and they get more popular. And you get inbreeding to sometimes non-durable kinds of horses. The racing surface are a problem. This so-called plastic stuff that they put down and then dug up at Santa Anita costs $1 million a furlong. That's an eighth of a mile. A mile costs $8 million. So it's a real racetrack to put up, and they turn out to be not quite as good as we hoped. Remember, in most places around the world, they race on grass a lot, so-called turf. We race less of that because when they go to Santa Anita, they're going to run there for 4 months. They're going to be there. So no grass is going to tolerate running 8 races a day with 10 horses in each of those there. So it's a real problem. Early or late training is very much like the pre-collegiate athlete. You know, the guys who are playing great in the NFL and the NBA necessarily weren't great high school basketball players. You know, there's different times of maturity and aging in this. You need to understand that a bit. And I said the worldwide shift towards faster sprinting is very interesting. The only source of stamina left in horse racing in the world right now is France. They kept horses that way, so anybody who wants horses to run over steeplechases or long fences, they're all taking French bred horses. The French bred horses win about 2/3 of the jumping championships at Cheltenham every year, just because they've consistently bred for stamina. Now, continue. I told you about 8 bells and the toe grabs and the inside rims. This was a trainer who's a good guy. He would have never thought it would have hurt her. If he'd never seen that, he'd never let it happen. But the truth is, they're always trying to take an edge. So the toe grabs have now been basically eliminated around the United States. Butazolidine will have been converted to such a low dose that it's physiologically insignificant, and it'll be gone another year. We have been unable to do any good in trying to get something done about the use of Lasix. There's complete disagreement between California and the eastern part of the United States. California wants to use Lasix to minimize bleeding. The rest of us have pretty well agreed to get rid of it. So we'll see what happens. The Breeders' Cup will be at Santa Anita again this fall, and what we do about that for the championship races remains to be seen. I'm not saying what's right or wrong about it. I'm obviously on the side of the people in the East who think that getting rid of all these would be good for our horses and good for us, but you've got to get a consensus, and that's why we don't have a budget in this country. We can't get an agreement about Lasix for the same reason. The bicarbonate loading thing I told you about is pretty obvious. If you can get a low PCO2, or a high PCO2, then you've had some milkshakes, some bicarbonate given before your race. That gets you disqualified and a little bit fine. Anabolic steroids are a big issue. A great example of that's a drug called clenbuterol, which was used to help horses breed here. Turns out clenbuterol, like sort of the fine print in the physician's desk reference, clenbuterol is a phenomenal increase in muscle mass and agility and whatnot. It has a whole bunch of secondary effects that are very significant for compounding what you're doing with horses. Compounding pharmacies are big problems. Veterinary pharmacies don't have to have any of the kind of registration things that you know, and the illegal designer drugs like the frog and elephant juice are very good examples. Laboratories, I've told you the one at Davis is the best example. We now do a good job of vets on the track reporting injuries. We report riders when they're hurt. Very interesting, the riders will not agree to a personal health record. That means if they've either got drugs on board or whatnot, you know, you'll never know it. So they don't allow any testing of themselves, even though we tried to do it for their benefit. The uneven penalties thing is really interesting. Richard Dutro Jr., his father was a great trainer. He's been absolutely an embarrassment. He won the Derby with Big Brown. We just after 147 violations in 10 years and literally $1 million in law fees, we finally got him ruled off the racetrack where you can't train a horse anymore. is number one guy in this whole field has really just been the biggest abuser you've seen. And there's about, well, I'll show you, I think that essentially 1.5% of the trainers get in trouble with doing things like this. The other 98.5% are the best guys in the world looking after things. So many of these other things you know about, frozen samples like the Olympics that we need to have and do things there, out of competition testing, the shockwave ultrasound, these are all research things. There's a thing called the Grayson Foundation, named for Woodrow Wilson's physician, Admiral Carey Grayson, who then put his estate into preserving research on racehorses and in veterinary schools. And then Paul Mellon matched that with another $2 million. And Jack Oxley, who used to live and work here a good bit, put up another $1 million. And so we've got a decent kind of thing of about $20 million. Try to give $1 million a year, the 5% off that, to vet schools for research, primarily in things that are athletic, orthopedic, reproductive, or infectious. Virtually all of them go that way, and I happen to be on the board to help sort that out. In any case, let's hit a few things. Here are the places and the drugs. And if you want to look at this, NSAIDs are the number one thing for violations. Number two are steroids, adrenergic drugs, anabolics, you're going to see what that is, ulcer drugs, a lot of them done. Here are the violations by category of drug. It's pretty clear that NSAIDs at 1,000 over a 5-year period is a lot. We've now made that illegal and think we'll be able to enforce getting rid of that. 1.5% of people, fewer than 200 trainers, account for virtually all of the drug rulings. Most of those are in 5 states. The good news is you run second to Florida. And it's also interesting, if you look there, that West Virginia and Minnesota, which are notorious for having really, really bad racing, are in the same thing with you. So it's a real problem where you've been much more liberal in California than I think you ought to be. This is a horror picture from the New York Times about 1 year ago. This is a horse who broke his legs and died in a sheep claiming race in New York. Those were the medications he'd had in the week before he died. So if you think we've got a problem, we've got a real problem. And trying to get control of this and stop it and get the labs to enforce it and people to espouse this higher level performance has been hard, but we've made progress to the point where we're really stuck on one thing. This is what the newspaper looks like. So you can see exactly what they're. Volatile mix of speed and drugs. Laurel Park in Maryland, Tom Amos in Kentucky, Racing Commission International, Asmussen, one of our leading trainers. He was found being guilty, got a 6-month vacation. He said he loved it. He put his assistant in charge of the thing. First time he'd ever been able to get to his kids' softball games and Little League games. So the punishment didn't fit the crime at all. So we've tried to improve that now where that can't happen anymore. Even the Santa Barbara newspaper has got this sort of thing. And there are two things in here you need to do. The run to death at racetracks is a thing in New Mexico has been horrible. New York Times has done a lot on this. The Kentucky horse industry is worth billions, but it's worth less than it was 10 years ago. And most of those billions are in the holdings of people from overseas, the Irish, the Arabs, the Japanese, and a few of continuing American people who work at that. The alignment of the planets really occurred in 2008, in which the Jockey Club created a safety committee to look into this, and we'd had a lot of work and a lot of help. We had trainers, riders, other people there. Track operators, first time I've ever seen all these people in one room. So we came together and began to work on this in a sensible way. And while I don't know how many thousand hours I've spent on this in the last 5 years, it's probably been worthwhile. Very interesting. New versions of international outcross. Stamina in France, durability in Germany. You want to look anywhere else? That's the places where for whatever things happen, they kept breeding to a pattern and have a different type horse. The rescue initiatives of the unwanted horse, we've saved an awful lot of horses from slaughter pens. And what's the right thing to do about slaughter horses? You put them to sleep there, do you let them starve to death in a pasture? Not enough is a tremendous ethical issue. I'd say for me, it's at least as hard as the issue about abortion and immigration. It's a moral thing that I sure don't begin to know the answer. But it's not solved and it's still a part of what we do. The basic pharmacology, this will be known to most of you because some of you take these drugs. Lasix is a wonderful diuretic. I always take my Lasix in the afternoon when I get back from a lecture here, not before I come. Clenbuterol, we told about bronchodilator, secondary exercise and muscle enhancement. The reference laboratory, as UC Davis, is just a model for how to get that done. But again, this is the sort of thing we try to work through on a regular basis. The enforcement thing is been really a problem. The laboratories have generally been no good, poorly funded, and almost no research component. Somebody said they never had a positive in Delaware because that's all they threw all the specimens away. So you never get a, Florida has the most violations, but minor penalties. They've got a huge number, but you get a $500 penalty, and that's nothing for somebody like that. Lance Armstrong and erythropoietin, you can imagine erythropoietin has been used in racehorses for a long time. It is an intolerable long-term thing, and you always get a graft versus host kind of response in that. And then all the illegal and unknown drugs. So that's what we're doing. The progress we've made, I think, has been something I'm very proud of. It's helped us a lot, but it's a long way to go before where what we want to do most of all. I think racing and horse breeding is the ultimate green industry. We've not sold that very well. You couldn't have anything that is better for the climate that we talk about. We're trying to reach out to the social media and a younger demographic of people. There are too many fat old guys in their undershirts walking around the backstretch of racetracks. We need some balanced subsidies about our relationship with the casinos. Casinos and lotteries are not going to go away. Horse racing and horse breeding is a good sport and a good industry. And it's good for the place that has it, but we've got to find a balanced subsidy. And you know, the problem with that is when your government here is bankrupt, the city of Detroit is bankrupt, their bankruptcy is government everywhere, and all they're going to do is look for more money from somewhere. And right now, the cheap, easy source of money is our casinos and lottery games. This is a complicated thing. We need to get our nose in the tent and be part of this, or we're going to be completely left out, because racing, no matter how glorious I think it is, depends entirely on this sort of thing, having some support from gambling as a legal business. The three most important women in my life are Mrs. Revere, Northern Emerald, and my wife, Susan Galandia. It's a way to put your life together. Thank you for your attention. It's been an honor to be here, and you're kind to listen to what I had to say. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
What are you doing in your own breeding program? Are you now interbreeding with German horses?
Yes, we did that once. We've only got a small operation. We had most we ever had was 6 mares, so we've got 2 now. And yes, if you're looking for us, we imported a mare from Germany. She got small and backward foals, and we finally sold her on to India, where she's in a very high class stud there. Maybe she'll be happier there. We tried. I believe in it. I mean, if you can put this kind of thing together, you obviously believe in it. But you know, when you're in as one, it's not like you've got a herd of 10 mares to try to get one foal out of. You're going to have one foal every 2 out of every 3 years. So we tried, and it didn't turn out as well as I like, but that's the way it is. Yes?
Any thoughts on the Mustang problem in this country?
No, sir. It's a same thing of the unwanted horse. And in some places, if they're in a place where there's not a concentration, they don't interfere with raising cattle or other things, then they're not a problem. But boy, when they get close to where you are, it's the same thing with the unwanted quarter horse, the occasional unwanted racehorse, which you see way much of back in the East. But it just adds to the problem. And keeping a horse of any kind up is an expensive endeavor, even if you're not paying for it. They're going to eat a lot of grass and graze a lot of ground, and they're going to take things away from cattle and sheep and other things that have a more direct commercial value. It's not an easy subject. Yes, ma'am.
Is there any update on Rachel Alexander?
Yeah, she's in pretty good order. She had a reoperation about 7 or 8 days ago. As you may know, she had a foaling problem, which they've tried to keep secret, but she had a problem with getting hypotensive after a delivery and infarcted some bowel, had the bowel resected, put it back together again. She's done extremely well after that. And then she had an intra-abdominal abscess, which is not surprising any of the surgeons here, that sort of thing happens. That's been drained, and the last news as of 3 or 4 days ago, she was in good order again. Incredibly resilient, nice horse, getting wonderful care from very good veterinarians. Yes, ma'am.
No disrespect to horses, but in France and England, don't they use horse meat for feeding humans?
So no, it's been common in France for all of my lifetime. I did a fellowship at the Pasteur in 1979, so it's been common over there for a long time. I don't think it is in England. They generally are sort of there in love with their horses, and they don't want to do that, but it's a psychological thing, I think, rather than a technical one. And what happened is I think the meat providers began to dilute beef with horse meat because it's cheaper. you know, a horse that you can end up rendering for I don't know how many hundred pounds of meat out of is going to cost $600 or $700 at that stage of the game. So it's a relatively cheap source of meat. But it's commonly done in France and has been for...
But wouldn't that increase the horse's commercial value or another...
Would it increase the value?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's part of the reason. It would be an answer to the unwanted horse and find some way to humanely put them away. But if you put them away with any kind of drug, then that makes their meat unconsumable for human use in America. I'm not saying it ought to be, but that's just the way it is. And then the alternative, if you put them to sleep, you put them to sleep with a bolt, one of those guns that do that, but that's not a uniformly quick and fatal proposition. So I think there's a lot to what you say, ma'am, but I don't know where the right answer for that is for the industry and everybody. Yes, ma'am.
Are there drugs commonly used for worming and other things to maintain horses that make them improper as food sources?
I don't know. She's just asked about worming things that are given to horses from the time they're 6 months old. I absolutely don't know, don't have any idea. But that would be so commonly done, then it'd be basically only the most wild Mustang would have never had any worming kind of thing. Most all of them do to one degree or another. Yes, sir?
Is there one track in the United States that's outstanding compared to others?
You want to talk for safety or quality or what? Well, I mean, let me tell you. I think the best racing in America is at Saratoga Springs in upstate New York, and that's probably the best quality. What's the safest is a little harder to tell. They've been through things. Keeneland tried to have an artificial track that was safe. Santa Anita tried to reproduce it and got more breakdowns than ever. So it's been a hard, hard game because, remember, the artificial tracks all were in England. They've never been exposed to hot weather like you all have out here. They've never been exposed to the kinds of rains you have in the winter here. And so the fact the experiment didn't work in California, it worked in England, is no surprise, I think, to anybody looking at anything about material science. So I don't know what's the safest track in America. Grass tracks are safer than any dirt or synthetic things. But we still have a problem sorting that out because 80% of our racing is on dirt. Yes, sir, again.
Can I borrow your tip sheet?
No, listen, I worked my way through medical school betting on horses, and I wouldn't bet $1,000 a year now. You know, you don't need to do that. You bet enough by the time you feed them. You've got enough riding on them when they walk to the gate.
I bet you had $2 on Moran.
Did you really?
Yes.
When the match race with Seabiscuit when he got beat? All right, that's a wrong place to be.
I still root for Moran.
That's all right. That's good. Yes, sir.
I found it remarkable when you said that a sire now can cover 100 mares instead of 40 mares.
200.
200.
In each hemisphere.
Do they allow artificial insemination?
No. And I won't try to defend that. Artificial insemination has been prohibited by the organized jockey clubs of England, France, the United States for all of the 50 years it's been possible. The answer is no, we don't do it. You know, the trotting horse business, the standard breds got into it for a while. There'd been some of that and other kind of competition horses. But to make a long story short, it's not going to happen in thoroughbreds anywhere in the world, I think, in anybody in this room's lifetime. Not likely to do. Well, listen, y'all, yes?
It does happen, but it is not legal. Put it that way. But if they're breeding 200 mares a year, if a horse is, you can double cover him maybe twice a week. That's where he breeds a mare in the morning, a mare in the afternoon. But if you breed that horse too many times every day, he's shooting blanks.
The science behind that and the sense behind it's very good. Turns out there are some stallions that end up impregnating 200 mares a year, northern and southern hemisphere. Wow. But it's an exceptional horse, and you know that's another whole thing. Somewhere in here, I said fertility was very important. It is very important. Listen, thank you very much for your interest. Appreciate it.
Before everyone leaves, I just want to make an aside. This is what we've been exposed to in surgery from Dr. Polk. The wealth and depth of the information is just unbelievable. And so this was impressive. What he's been doing for us is super impressive. I do want to invite you all to the reception across the street. And I also want to remind you that he's going to give another, and I think it'll be equally as interesting lecture tomorrow afternoon around 2:30. Thanks for coming.